Hola a todos. Good afternoon. This is Abelardo de la Peña Jr., Director of Marketing and Communications with La Plaza de Cultura y Artes, and welcome to our latest edition of En Casa con La Plaza. We have, first of all, I know things are a little tense. We've been having, of course, the pandemic has been with us for the past few months. A lot of unrest and protest, rightly so, over the past few days, the past week actually, but we're gonna give a little diversion here. Of course, we have to recognize what's going on out in our communities, out of the streets, out in the world. But for now, let's look at not really the brighter side of the pandemic, but at least something that is recording the history in a different way than what the media has been portraying. Of course, there's some media out there that has been on it. And to talk to us about it today, we have with us Professor Marissa Lopez. As you probably saw, it was listed as Associate Professor Marissa Lopez with UCLA, but now she's a full professor and she'll talk to us a little bit about it, I'm sure. We're going to be showing some videos, some YouTubes. I'm sure you could already hear that on my background. Here, let me just mute myself real quick. We have with us Professor Marissa Lopez. As you probably saw, it was listed as Associate Professor Marissa Lopez with UCLA, but now she's a full professor.
I am not able to hear you for some reason.
Why don't you begin? With that brief introduction, tell us a little bit about yourself. And like I said, we're going to have some videos going on at the same time. So we might see a couple of ads before the YouTube clips. But hey, that's part of the price we pay. Thank you.
It literally is part of the price we pay. Oh, well, thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here, and I'm excited to share all of this stuff with you and with the people who are watching. So I think the best way to start is to just dive right in. Like, let's listen to a little bit of Alani Roberto's Corrido del Coronavirus. That was in your post advertising this conversation. So let's hear a little bit of it. They released this in March, and they're a duo from Phoenix by way of Sinaloa. And their song. Song, you can let it. Okay. Say to let it play in the background while I talk, but that's fine. The song offers a little bit of perspective in the face of fear. Right, the press release for the song, it talked about how life is short and we should enjoy our loved ones while we can. And the song is really action oriented. It gives instructions. If you go watch it on your own later, you'll see it gives you instructions on how to wash your hands and use disinfectant. And how you can honor your elders by running errands for them and checking on them. So I want to talk about Alani Roberto and some of the other songs out there. We have some great videos to share with all of you this afternoon and some really great music. But before we talk about the music, I just want to take a step back, about 10 steps back. First, just to explain why I'm even talking about these songs in the first place, because I'm an English professor, I'm not a musicologist, I don't study pop culture even, and I'm just not, you know, your friend who's always up on top of the latest trends. And think cutting edge is not a word that comes to mind when people think of me first. So I discovered this body of music, though, because I was on Spotify looking for something totally different. So I was looking for songs about Zorro to go on a playlist for a collaboration that I am doing with the Los Angeles Explorers Club. The Los Angeles Explorers Club, they lead bike tours through LA, kind of themed bike tours. So I met them on Instagram. And why am I on Instagram? As my teenage son asks me all the time, why am I on Instagram? And what am I doing with the LA Explorers? So I want to explain that, and that's going to get us back to the songs. And than to what I can bring to the table in a discussion, a conversation about these songs. Because like you said, Abelardo, at the top, you said they've gotten some media attention, but really not a lot. But to that conversation that's already happening around these songs, I can bring a little literary history into the mix and give the music some backstory. So I'm a professor of English and Chicano studies at UCLA, and I'm on sabbatical this year. I have a fellowship from the American Council of Learned Societies, and the fellowship I have is a new one. I'm part of the first cohort of people who have it. It's called the Scholars in Society Fellowship, and the idea is to pair university scholars with public-facing institutions to develop collaborative, publicly engaged humanities projects. So I've been working since September with the Los Angeles Public Library downtown. And I am working with them to build an app. This is my project that I'm doing for the fellowship, to build an app that's gonna use geodata, a mobile app that will use geodata to show users images from LAPL archives and other archives, but primarily the Los Angeles Public Library's images pertaining to 19th century Mexican Los Angeles. So that app is under construction, but we're currently on all the platforms. You can find Picturing Mexican America here on Facebook. We're on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and soon TikTok, as soon as I can figure it out. So follow us to stay updated and get information about the app, but also to see some of the material that we're circulating. So we have a really active Instagram feed, and we're circulating images and trying to connect these visions of the past to things that are happening today. We want to change how people perceive the space of Los Angeles, right? How they think about who has rights to this space and what it means to belong. So just as a quick example, I want to share just a couple of our recent posts that have some bearing on what's happening today. So I will share with you. So this is a post that we did about a recent Instagram live chat that we did, and this is the image that you're looking at here is of Cristobal Aguilar. He was mayor of Los Angeles, who lost his re-election campaign to this guy, James Toberman, in 1872. So we had a conversation recently with the historian David Torres Roof about kind of that election and about how that election really changed the shape of LA politics and is a way to understand our current moment. So that's one post we did. Another brief example, this one we did just recently, is about something that happened in Los Angeles in 1871, the Chinese massacre in downtown. So you can follow us, you can find these posts. This is an image, a drawing of a kind of gambling saloon in Los Angeles from the 1850s, and it shows this kind of multiracial, it's not a coalition exactly, but it shows that Los Angeles was multiracial and people interacted together in these spaces in gambling dens. This is an image, sorry, I'll go over that. But despite that multiracial aspect of the city, that can still bred racialized violence. So these are the kinds of things that we're sharing on the feed, and I invite you to join us there. So that's the backstory of Picturing Mexican America and what we're doing. And it's called Picturing Mexican America, and we do recognize the Gabrielino Tongva people as the traditional caretakers of Los Angeles, the Los Angeles Basin and the South Channel Islands, but we're also really grappling with the fact that this space once was, it still is, and it's always going to be Mexican. So we're trying to find ways to help people understand and experience Los Angeles's Mexican past, its present, and its future. And so that's the big picture. That's the very big scene of why I'm on Instagram. So like I was saying, I found the coronavirus music while working on this collaboration with the LA Explorers Club. They reached out over Instagram to see if we wanted to do work together on self-guided rides. Right? Usually they do group rides, but obviously that's not a possibility right now. So they were looking to see if we could design a ride sort of using our content and their base to get people out in the city in different ways, and also getting them to experience the kinds of things that we're trying to create on the Instagram feed. So those rides They're under construction, but they're close to being finished. We're recording audio for them, so they'll be out in the next couple of weeks. Obviously, we want to wait till some things die down a little bit in the streets before we send people out into the streets on their bikes, but we will do that eventually. So the audio for that bike ride is going to be on Spotify. You can find us on Spotify. We have playlists. All the songs that we're going to listen to today are also on our Spotify playlist. So that being said, you can also find the Los Angeles Explorers Club on Instagram if you want to learn more about them. So to bring all of this back to Alani Roberto, I was on Spotify looking for a song called El Corona, which is a song about Zorro by a band called the Suburban Legends. And it's about Don Diego Vega, otherwise known as Zorro, who's the fictional masked bandit of Southern California. He's like the Robin Hood of 19th century LA. So I was looking for this song, and it turns out that that song is not on Spotify. But all this other music is, right? All this other coronavirus music turned up when I was looking for El Corona. And it's not all corridos, but that's what I'm most interested in. And so we'll get to that in a second. But there's music of all genres out there, and it's all so interesting. So I want us to listen next to, or watch, Alex Garcia's rap, the rap del coronavirus, if you could call that up for us. Avalarda.
Wrong one.
Yeah. Sorry. I'm gonna get to that one. That's also a good one.
The coronavirus. So I'll get it right.
The rap, yeah.
Here it goes.
There we go.
Quédate en tu pinche casa, no estás de vacaciones. No por ser mexicano, nos sintamos tan fregones. Ponte a mirar películas comiendo chicharrones. Acostado, sentado hasta en calzones. Pero por favor, quédate en tu casa. Chingada madre, cabrón, que nada te pasa. Tu encerramiento valdrá mucho la pena. Hacer pedas en casa, no vendas de cuarentena. Hacer compras de pánico y llenarte la alacena.
Hey, you can leave this going in the background, and I'll just talk a little bit over it. So, Garcia's from Mexico. Actually, that's all I want to say about it. I mean, you can see that the lyrics are serious and a little bit funny at the same time, and he's telling people, like, this isn't a joke, it's not a game, like, just stay in your house, please, and wash your hands. So he's from Mexico, like I was saying, but I want to listen next to something that's U.S.-based, something by a U.S.-based artist, and it's called La Cumbia del Coronavirus, and it's by an artist named Mr. Cumbia, and this song was released in January, but it's been used in a lot of PSAs, including this one that we're going to watch from a hospital in Ecuador. So this music has a really transnational flow. So in this PSA, these are the actual healthcare workers at the hospital in, I think it's Ambato in Ecuador, and they have a line dance that they're doing where they're demonstrating how to wash your hands. These are actual like nurses and doctors, which I think is fantastic.
Coronavirus, coronavirus, lávense las manos
in. Well, I'll say, there you go. Those are your hand washing instructions. And you can leave this playing in the background while I talk a little bit. So Mr. Cumbia, he's saying in the song that the whole world is nervous because of a disease that broke out in China. It broke out in China, but we all still have to be alert. And he sings, and I'm quoting a loose translation. He says, let's be attentive. We have to take care. So let's roll up our sleeves and get to work. That's why I wrote this song. And so he's singing about washing your hands, about avoiding touching your face, and about using disinfectant. So here's, I want to listen next to another song that is really interesting to me. It's from Maso el Presidente, and he is a Christian Latin trap artist from Puerto Rico.
En Puerto Rico, desde cinco casos confirmados, la gobernadora firmó una orden ejecutiva para cerrar parcialmente todo el país.
Dímelo, Johnny. Hay que orar. Se arregló la pandemia. Pero tenga paz.
So this is just particularly interesting to me because I didn't even know that this was a genre, the Christian Latin trap, but it is, and it's huge, and Maso Presidente is a very big figure in this scene. And so if you watch the song on your own, you'll see the Christian themes emerging in the music. And so all these songs that we've, you know, just scratched the surface of here, these are all working like PSAs, so public service announcements. I mean, Mr. Cumbia's song is actually a PSA, but all these songs are trying to spread this message, you know, in the same way that Corridos did, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. You know, letting people know this is serious, take it seriously, here's what you can do to avoid it, and also you're trying to create some beauty out of what's really a lot of horror. So I just said they're functioning as PSAs, but Marco Flores y Laerez is taking a slightly different approach. So I want to take a listen to their song because they're going to bring us back around to the corrido and a little bit of music history. So let's listen to Marco Flores y Laerez.
Y ahora les presentamos el nuevo tema de Marco Flores y la Jerez, quien nos recuerda que al mal tiempo buena cara y con buen humor que hay que lavarnos muy bien las manos para cuidarnos de esta pandemia. Esto se llama el coronavirus.
Apologize in advance because that song is a total earworm. I guarantee you, you're going to be singing the song for the next 3 days. So he's saying, like I said, he's taking a slightly different approach from the other music that we've been listening to. He's saying, I don't really care about coronavirus. I've washed my hands. It's all good. So let's party, let's drink, and have a good time. Which, you know, we all need to do a little bit of that too. Like I said, it's a slightly different approach. So Banda Jerez, which is Marco Flores y la Jerez. So this Banda Jerez, they have been around for a long time. And like I said, they're gonna bring us back to the corrido and a little bit of music history. So they're from Zacatecas and they were formed in Zacatecas in the late 80s. And that banda sound that you're hearing in that song, especially, which makes it such an earworm, that banda sound is historically very much connected to the corrido, right? That big brass feel that dates to the mid 19th century in Mexico, when we start to see the emergence of different types of metal instruments. From the 1850s on, and we see village bands beginning to play music in the style of regional military bands as Mexico's moving into its early stages of nation formation after independence in 1821. So that sound is a really unique sound that emerges from the blend of traditional Mexican music with German polka. So there's a lot of German migration to Mexico in the 19th century, really like to all of Latin America in the mid to late 19th century. As these nations are newly forming, you have governments that are saying, basically, like, we need more white people here. Criollo governments are actively recruiting European migrants to their emerging nations. And so this is why there's a lot of German migration in the 19th century. And in addition to beer and whiteness, Germans brought the accordion to Mexico. So the accordion has become probably the singular feature of Northern Mexican music, what we know as norteño. And I talked about this a couple of weeks ago on Instagram Live. We had a conversation with Alvaro del Norte, who's a punk rock accordion player from San Antonio. He's fronts a band called Piñata Protest. And if you haven't heard them, go find them on Spotify. They're amazing. And our conversation about the accordion and other things, that's on Picturing Mexican America's IGTV, Instagram TV, if you want to go find it there. So let's circle back though to Alani Roberto, as I keep promising I'm going to do. So that was the first corrido that I saw, although there are a few others out there, and we saw a little snippet of one that we'll come back to in a minute. And it caught my attention, Alani Roberto did, they caught my attention because corridos are a 19th century genre. And that's really our jam at Picturing Mexican America. It's my jam as a scholar of 19th century America, broadly defined. So I want to talk a little bit about what the corrido is and why it's such a perfect genre for this musical moment. So corridos, they're border ballads, right? And there are songs in the Mexican and Spanish ballad tradition, and they become really, really popular in the border region in the period immediately following the transition to US rule. So that's 1848, after the Mexican-American War. And so that transition to US rule was long and complicated and very violent as the United States is attempting to incorporate all this new land. The United States doubled in size, more than doubled in size, after the Mexican-American War. So it's incorporating vast new territories, and lots of people, lots and lots of people are in this territory. So as that's happening, tensions erupt, predictably, and class and race hierarchies emerge that we continue to live with today. So we begin to have the sense, as we move towards the end of the 19th century, this is where we get the sense of Chicanos living in really antagonistic relationship to Anglo-Americans. So in South Texas, for example, the Rangers emerge as a paramilitary force to keep Mexicans in line, really. And then the Rangers are a precursor to the Border Patrol. So various cultural texts are emerging as we're moving into the 20th century, the end of the 19th, into the 20th. Lots of different kinds of cultural production is emerging to record this transition for us, and including corridos. And one of the most popular and well-known is about a man named Gregorio Cortez. And we wrote about him in an Instagram post on Picturing Mexican America. So Gregorio Cortez is a real person who shot a sheriff. And he shot a sheriff who shot and killed his brother because the sheriff thought that the two had stolen a horse, and this was a mistake, and it was a mistake, a translation mistake that ended in tragedy. So the song, there's a song emerged about this event, and that song was made into a movie in 1982 starring Edward James Olmos, and that's what you're going to see in this video. Abelardo, if you can share that for us. So we'll listen to a little bit of the song, and you can enjoy young Edward James Olmos. Well, I'll talk over this a little bit. So Picturing Mexican America, like I said, we're on Spotify. We have a playlist. Oh, there he is. Edward James Olmos. looking very dashing in the early 80s. This song is on our Corrido playlist, as well as a bunch of others. I encourage you to go find them and listen to them. You can hear Drogoy or Cotet, this one in its entirety, and like I said, a bunch of other ones. So Corridos, as a form, as a musical form, as a lyric form, they were first taken up as an object of study in the 1950s by a guy named Américo Pérez, who's generally thought of as like the father of Chicano studies. And we did a post recently about, I will show, this book that he wrote. This is by Américo Pérez with his pistol in his hand. And it's a book that's all about Gregorio Cortez. And Paredes teaches us in this book what we learned from him. He teaches about the form and the function of the corridos. And then he does a really deep dive into Cortez. So the first part of the book is about, I can't remember if it's the first part or the second part. One half of the book is about the corrido form and the kind of ethnomusicological analysis. And the second half of the book is about Cortez himself and sort of what happens in the aftermath of the shooting. So if you're not looking for an academic read, you might find with his pistol in his hand a little dry, maybe. But it has also compiled this book. So if you're just looking for songs and stories, I encourage you to take a look at this, the Texas Mexican Canzonero. There's a fair amount of scholarship in here, but also just songs. So you get notes and tabs if you play guitar, and lyrics and a little bit of backstory. And so I highly recommend this book. So this is Paredes's work and in part his life's work. So in this book, back to the relatively dry academic read, but also a really important book. In With His Pistol in His Hand, you can learn about the different European forms that corridos borrow from. You learn about how they're sung, mostly by men, and that they're mostly about manly men doing manly things. You also learn about the different modes of performance, right? So I've been giving you a lot of history about where this form comes from, but how were they actually sung and how were they performed? And so Paredes tells us about this. And they were sung by contributors walking around, either in bar settings or party settings or walking through towns. And you learn also that they're mostly about manly men doing manly things, but those manly men are often bandits. And bandits involved in sometimes really important historical events. So here's one about Juan Cortina, for example. So here's a manly bandit man involved in important historical events. So let's listen to a little bit of this and I'll tell you the story. I'm not hearing the music. But that's okay. So Cortina is a really important figure in 19th century Mexican American history, Chicano history. He came from a rich family. He's born in South Texas in Brownsville. He came from a pretty wealthy family, but he became a kind of Mexican Robin Hood. I was trying to find a different phrase since I used that to describe Zorro, but that's Cortina. He organized Mexican-American guerrilla fighters in resistance to Anglo-American rule after the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo. That's the treaty that ended the Mexican-American War. You saw an image of that in the video. It split Mexico in half. After that treaty, Cortina drummed up a guerrilla army, a guerrilla resistance army. He wrote a manifesto about social justice for Mexicans in Texas, and he was eventually driven out of the state to Mexico, where he fought in Mexico for the Mexican army against the French, which is a whole other story. But he did that in the 1860s before coming back to the United States to work as a Union spy against the Confederates during the Civil War. So that's an example of the kinds of things that corridos are being written about in the 19th century. I want to play another song about smuggling. This is Mariano Resendez. And there are a lot of versions of this song out there on YouTube, but I chose this one just because I love the picture. It's so fabulous. A little bit of the lyrics.
Año de 1900.
We'll talk a little bit over it. Like I said, the picture was too good to not show. Again, all these songs, including this Resendez one, Mariano Resendez, these are on our Picturing Mexican America's Corrido playlist. That's on Spotify. You can find it there. And smuggling is the way that we can bridge corridos of the past with corridos of the present. Because Paredes's work is fantastic. It's impossible to overstate how important his work is. But he wrote it in the 1950s, assuming that the corrido form had died out. The controlling assumption in this book is that the corrido's golden age was 1848 to 1930. But anybody with even a passing knowledge of Latino music knows that corridos are hugely popular today, mostly in the form of the narco corrido. And these are songs that glorify smuggling and drug cartels. So narco corridos become really, really popular in the United States with the success of Los Tigres del Norte, whose first big hit was one of my all-time favorite songs, Contrabando y Traición. So let's just play a little bit of that because it's so good, if we can. I'm pretty sure this isn't an official video.
Y Camelia la Tejana.
So you see in the video basically what the song is about. They're smuggling marijuana across the border before it's legal. And so this song is written in the 70s. It's about this fictional woman, Camelia la Tejana. Long Beach Opera a few years ago commissioned an opera about her. So Camelia, she shoots poor Emilio and runs off with the loot after they get across the border. So this band, Los Tigres, I mean, everybody knows this band, or you should know this band. So Google them if you've never heard of them before. So they're hugely popular, but interesting side note, you probably didn't know, but in 2000, they donated $500,000 to UCLA to establish a fund at UCLA called the Tigres del Norte Fund. And that fund funds the study of border music at UCLA. So really interesting group. Topic for a whole other time. So of course we can't talk about the history of corridos, the recent history of corridos at least, without talking about this guy. So let's just dive right into playing the Chalino, and I will talk a little bit about him.
Soy Lucas,
tengo 4 años. Huge, so
that's a lot.
Obviously we're gonna have a snack.
Tronaron la espada por la espalda de un valiente en flores y azacatecas.
So Chalino Sanchez was, he still is, wildly popular, and he was part of this narco corrido wave that followed on the heels of Los Tigres del Norte. He was from northwestern Mexico. He worked in Central California. He was a migrant worker in Central California, and his music included stories about drug trafficking, murders and crooked police officials, as well as songs about the struggles of working class Mexicans. So a lot like Los Tigres, but you can see just in the way he holds his body, and you can hear, if you go listen to his songs, hear in the quality of his voice, the production quality of the music, it's all really different from Los Tigres. So similar in topic and subject, but a little bit different in form and production. And all of that is not the most interesting thing about Chalino. He was killed in 1992, and he's become a cult figure, a really very much a cult figure. So we're sort of moving slowly, step by step, into the present. So we have the Corridos of the 19th century, we have Los Tigres, like really opening up that genre as we move towards the end of the 20th century, and singers like Chalino benefiting from and continuing to build that wave of popularity. And then in the 90s and the early 2000s, we see a real rise in Narco Corridos. And one of the most visible bands producing these is Los Tucanes de Tijuana. So let's hear a little bit from them. I couldn't find a good video, so we're just gonna look at them. Looking awesome. Listen to a verse or two, and I'll tell you a little bit about this one. So this song is called El Más Bravo de los Bravos. You can see that up at the top of the screen. And it's about Raidel Uriarte, who is a prominent trafficker with the Tijuana cartel. So his nickname is El Muletas, or Crutches. And Los Tucanes wrote a song about him, another song about him that was called El Muletas. And you can find that on our on Picturing Mexican America Spotify playlist. So this one, Mas Bravo de los Bravos, is not a traditional corrido. There's a certain formula they follow. They tend to have an invocation, like, hey, everybody, listen to me. And there's no, in El Mas Bravo, there's no clear date or event outlined. It's just kind of like an homage to this person. Typically, corridos are in ballad form, so in rhyming quatrains, so like little paragraphs of four lines that rhyme. So in some ways, the song is not a traditional corrido, but sonically, the sound, and you remember, I hope you remember, or you can go back and listen to Marco Flores y Banda Jerez, like their Coronavirus song. I was talking about that banda sound. I really get that in this one, in the Tucanes song. Drums are not a traditional corrido instrument. Historically, corridistas were, they performed like troubadours, like I said, walking around, so drums are a little hard to incorporate there. But the accordion, the fiddle, the guitar, it's all there. And they are in waltz or polka time. And again, that's the German influence. So corridos, they do two things, as we've heard. They glorify marginal outsider figures like Camelia La Tejana, but corridos also celebrate historical figures and events like El Mas Bravo. El Mas Bravo, it recounts a series of exploits. He's celebrating an important figure, an important complicated figure. And so corridos function now as a kind of oral history, like a musical wire service, you know, a way of communicating stories and news and history. And that's how they've historically functioned. That's how they emerged, you know, as a way to celebrate history that wasn't being recorded, as a way to spread the news about things that were happening in distant lands. That's how they function historically. And that's how they are working now. So let's listen to one more corrido. This is a pretty traditional corrido. And this is the one that we got a snippet of earlier. This is by Los Potrillos de Curicato. Thank you.
mundo nos ha golpeado, famoso coronavirus. Ya son bastantes las vidas que por ti se han destruido. No distingues sociedades, te llevas pobres y ricos.
Corridos. Like this one, like I said, it's a very traditional in sounds and form and even in the structure of the story and information. They've always been a kind of musical borderlands news service. And today they're reporting and they're informing and they're proving that the genre is alive and well, and it's not going anywhere anytime soon. So like I said, all these songs are available. If you want to hear them in their entirety and enjoy them on your own time, you can find them on our Spotify playlist for Picturing Mexican America. And you can also find Picturing Mexican America on Instagram and Facebook if you want to keep learning interesting stuff about 19th century Mexican American history. So that's my piece that I have to say about corridos and contemporary coronavirus corridos, but I'm curious. I have not been watching the chat, so I don't know if there is any chat or if there are any questions or if you have questions.
There's some comments here. Gerson Bernal, he likes Chalino songs.
Yeah.
So that's one that that came in. That is Chalino. Says Marco Lopez had a unique voice that no one seems to be able to recreate.
Yeah. Well, like I said, I mean, it's an earworm. It's just, like, once you listen to it, it just stays in there. But yeah, it's great music.
And Marco Lopez, he says Tres Animales is also another song that describes the pitfalls of being involved in narcotráfico.
Okay. Tres Animales.
All right. Yeah. And then Michelle Coates, when you talked about Los Tigres del Norte giving a sizable donation to UCLA, cool fact.
Yes. I'm full of cool random facts.
All right. And there
I will just say another cool fact that UCLA maintains a website, a digital archive of border music. It's called the Frontera Collection. You can just Google that. And you can listen to and make your own playlists of corridos and actually all different kinds and genres of border music. It's a really wonderful resource.
All right. And Chispa Hills says, I really like the presentation. It ties a lot together.
Thank you. I tried.
And Rocio Centeno, my jefa was born in Chihuahua, Mexico. I grew up on corridos norteños.
It's such good music. It's really fantastic music. And, you know, those of you who are commenting about liking Chalino and liking norteño, if you don't know Piñata Protest, I mentioned them a little bit earlier in our conversation, how on Picturing Mexican America, if you find us on Instagram, and find our IGTV, Instagram TV, you'll see we had an Instagram live with Alvaro del Norte, who's the lead singer of Piñata Protest, and he plays the accordion. We had a wide-ranging conversation about, about a lot of things, but about the importance of keeping this music alive, but keeping it alive in these different relevant forms. And He's amazing. The band is amazing. Again, that's Piñata Protest, and you can find them on Spotify.
Here's another one about a recent trend in corridos, trap corridos.
Thoughts? So that I don't know about.
Okay, well, here's any thoughts on the LA-based genre known as trap corridos with acts such as Arsenal Efectivo. And another, that was Marty Preciado asking that. And Lucero Saldana, have you found any trap corridos over coronavirus? So I guess that's a little bit more research you got to be doing.
Yeah, thank you so much for that question and for asking. And I'm whoever it was that asked that question, you asked if I have any thoughts, but do you have any thoughts? Put those in the chats and I will totally research that. You know, I teach at UCLA, I teach, the courses that I teach are cross-listed. So they're English and Chicano studies, and one of the classes I teach, I'm teaching it this summer and this fall, it's early Chicano lit, we go from the Aztecs through the Mexican Revolution, right, so the 1400s through 1920, and we spend a lot of time on corridos, and this is a really excellent information for me to have, just to find ways to keep making this material feel relevant and current. Not just make it feel relevant and current, but to demonstrate to students, like, it is relevant and current. Like, this history is important to know.
Well, this is a fellow academic, Lucero Saldana. I'm a professor at San Antonio College and interested in researching trap corridos. So maybe here's a little cross research that you could do together.
Definitely, please reach out. You know, I'm Marissa Lopez at UCLA, mklopez@ucla.edu. Please be in touch. I would love to think about this together with you. And if you're in San Antonio, you should go see a pinata protest.
All right. Well, that's what we're all, thank you so much, Marissa. This was really interesting. I don't have my boots on, but as soon as this is over, I'm gonna put on some corrido music. Where can we hear corrido music over the airwaves?
Oh my gosh, that's a great question. I don't know. Like I said, I am not the person who's totally up on current events. I don't listen to them on the radio. I listen to them on CD.
That's if anybody out there knows, please drop us a line, drop Marissa a line, and so we could get on the bandwagon here.
Put it in the chat, please, any radio stations that are playing.
And here's from Rebecca Horta, something a little bit more current. It'll be interesting to see any corridos or cumbias related to the recent unrest.
Yeah, I was really hoping to find some, you know, because with YouTube and Spotify, it's so easy for groups to get their music together and put it out there. So I was hoping to find some, and I did not. But, you know, anybody who's listening to this, please, if you ever find anything interesting, please, 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 you can find me on Facebook. I'm on all of the things, and you can reach out to me directly over email.
Well, fantastic. Well, thank you. And you can also reach out to La Plaza on our Facebook page. Those of you are here online live streaming, thank you so much for joining us and for your comments on Zoom as well. This has been a really very catchy and interesting presentation. And that's what we're here for, sharing with you out there at home, at work, on the road, through your phone, through your computer, through your laptop. Just what we normally do at La Plaza de Cultura y Artes is our presentations, discussions, observations, performances. And so with that, I'd like to just ask you to join us this coming week. We have a few other things going on, and I'm gonna just bring up my, tomorrow night, we have Julissa Arce, an author, an award-winning author. She's gonna be reading from her memoir, Someone Like Me, How One Undocumented Girl Fought for Her Place Here in the United States. And she'll be in conversation with a student from Laverne University, Kimberly Hernandez, on Friday. And that's tomorrow at 7, Thursday at 7. Then on Friday, a first for La Plaza. We have had a couple of musical performances, live musical performances, but this is going to be one where we have three musicians in three different places. It'll be the African influence in Latin American music, which is a programming that we have done and would have done at La Plaza in concurrence with our Afro-Latinidad, Mi Casa, My City exhibition, which is currently still on our walls. And hopefully soon you'll be able to join us at our museum, our museum's galleries. But this will be Beto Arcos, an independent radio journalist, giving a presentation about this, the African influence, and then we'll have guest musicians Cesar Castro, Angelo Salazar, and Eduardo Martinez actually performing for us. So that's it for today. Thank you so much. It's a warm day outside, so might want to get ourselves a little drink after this. I know I am. And thanks again to Marissa. Thanks to the staff of La Plaza de Cultura y Artes for offering this forum for all of you to continue to learn about our culture, our history, our art, in a way that is suitable for these times. Thanks to our sponsors, Walmart and AARP California, who have generously helped us out with the funding of this programming. And thanks to all of you for showing up and enjoying this and for your comments, questions, and so on. And we'll see you soon. And buenas tardes a todos. Be safe, be healthy, and we'll see you.
Buenas. Thank you.